Good morning, LCF. It's a beautiful day to gather together and to hear the word of the Lord, to remember that Christ indeed come and he has fulfilled the word of God. And so we will be reading today, a special reading, from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verse 57 to 79. Luke chapter 1, verse 57 to 79. It's a longer portion, so let's just enjoy the word of God together. Now the time came for Elizabeth to give birth, and she bore a son. And her neighbors and relatives heard that the Lord had shown great mercy to her, and they rejoiced with her. And on the eighth day, they came to circumcise the child. And they would have called him Zechariah after his father. But his mother answered, "No, he shall be called John." And they said to her, "None of your relatives is called by this name." And they made signs to his father, inquiring what he wanted him to be called. And he asked for a writing tablet and wrote, "His name is John." And they wondered. And immediately his mouth was opened and his tongue loosed, and he spoke, blessing God. And fear came on all their neighbors, and all these things were talked about through all the hill country of Judea. And all who heard them laid them in their hearts, saying, "What then will this child be?" For the hand of the Lord was with him. And his father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, saying, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people in the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, whereby the sunrise shall visit us from on high, to give light to those who sit in darkness, in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace." Let's pray. Father God, we thank you because you are indeed a faithful God, who promised and fulfilled, and who makes promises and he will fulfill. We thank you, Lord, for all the words of the holy prophets of old, all the promises that you have given to our fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. These, Lord, are our promises indeed. We are your church. We are the true Israel. And so, Lord, you did indeed raise a horn of salvation in the house of your servant David, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who is the light of the world, who is the Savior of the world. So, Lord, I pray that as your people, we would boast in nothing else other than Jesus Christ, our Savior. Lord, may your word be indeed treasured in our hearts, that we would hold it dear. May your promises refresh us. Help us endure, persevere, and indeed rejoice. Rejoice because we serve a faithful God who is sovereign over all, the author and finisher of our faith, the Alpha and the Omega, that even though we might think that we are but a weak church, full of sin and discouragement in times of hardship, but Lord, we also know that it is not by might or by power, but salvation comes from the Lord. God, you are the Lord. You are the sovereign of the universe. You are the creator of all things. And you came into this world as a child to save wretched sinners like us, because you are the God of love. We thank you for what you have done. And Lord, we just ask you, Holy Spirit, that you would come and you would bless your people this morning. You would anoint the speaker to proclaim this good news, to free the captives, to move hearts, to stir up our affections, and that we would rejoice together in this amazing gospel of our salvation to the glory of your name. And God's people said, Amen.
Amen. Let's worship together.
House forever.
we do. Is all creation groaning? It is. Is a new creation coming? It is. It is. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? He is. Does the Father truly love us? He does. Does the Spirit move among us? He does. And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves? He does. Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, he is David's root. People and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priests to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy?
Hope awaits in Bethlehem. shepherds stare and wise men bow. Angels sing with songs of joy. A light is blazing in the night. The glory of the promised Christ. Hope awakes, hope awakes, hope awakes in Bethlehem. Heaven smiles on his face. Hope awakes. Silence breaks, creation sighs. Come and see the Word alive. Infant eyes of majesty, tiny hands that hold the world, swaddling clothes. David's town. Will you bring your king a gift? Come and worship and adore, age to age, forevermore. Come and adore. Come.
Come and adore.
Come and worship forever. Come and adore.
Lift your eyes, offer praise. Hope awakes in Bethlehem. Heaven smiles on his face. Hope awakes in
That was beautiful, wasn't it? Praise, what's beautiful. Thank you, Emma. Thank you, Azul. Can you believe it? We're at the end of the year. It's nearly Christmas. And we're still going through COVID season. Whoever would have thought that it would last this long? It's unthinkable. And this is our time when we can catch up with our giving, and we are grateful to God for the way the Lord has been providing, for the way the Lord has been touching hearts. And this month is time when we can bless others. And there are missionaries that we want to bless, there are families that we want to bless here at LCF, and we've been doing it, and we're grateful to God that through the giving of God's faithful people, that is what has been happening. And I see several children with us, not only Emma and Azul, but others, and that's wonderful. And we make it a point to bring your children every time. We want them with us at our gatherings. And thank you for coming on time, for those who did. This week, we meet for prayer. Now, I was hoping that we could meet in the morning, because I thought most people would be home, but there's a whole bunch of people working, so we're going to keep prayer at 7:30 Wednesday evening. Everything else is suspended, just prayer Wednesday, and then, of course, on Christmas Day, provided there are no other changes that the government will implement, we are meeting twice. The first gathering is at 9 a.m., and I'll be ministering at that gathering, and then the second gathering is at 10:30, and Andrew will be ministering at the second gathering. So for those of you who are early risers, come for the 9, and then those of you who have children can come for the 10:30. That's this Friday, Christmas Day. And then for the year-end gathering, we meet on Zoom. That's Wednesday, December 30th at 7:30 p.m. And there'll be special music, there'll be testimonies, a word of encouragement, and we're just going to thank the Lord for his goodness in keeping us throughout this season of COVID-19 and how he sustained us and used us for the edification of the church, for the spreading of the gospel, and how he encouraged us. Believe you me, this was not an easy thing. In fact, it's not humanly possible. Only by God's grace we were able to do it, and thank God for his grace. And so we're going to thank him, and then we're going to commend ourselves for 2021. We don't know how 2021 will look like. We don't know if it's going to be worse than 2020. It might be. But whatever it is, God is on the throne. We want to trust him, and that's what December 30th is all about. For those of you who sent out your letter to the NP of your writing, thank you for taking the time to do that. And if you haven't, you're still in time, but you need to do it this week, the latest. And women, there's a special course for you, as I've said, both at the Wednesday devotional and, of course, last week. It's an 8-week course on what is Reformed theology that is starting January 14th. It's Thursday, January 14th. Two ladies group, home groups that usually meet, will be joining as one, and then other ladies will be joining in as well. It's all on Zoom, and I'm hoping that all the ladies will be joining us for this 8-week course. Well, today I'd like to share from one verse found in John, the Gospel of John. So please turn to your Bibles in John chapter 1. John chapter 1. And we're looking at verse 5. Only two Gospels really narrate the nativity story. The Gospel of Matthew and the Gospel of Luke. And they do it from a different perspective. Matthew emphasizes Joseph and his role. Luke emphasizes Mary and her role. In fact, it's Mary that calls the child Jesus. Not Joseph, when you read the Gospel of Luke. And instead, when you read the Gospel of Matthew, you see Joseph's dream. Joseph, who was struggling whether or not he was to take Mary as wife when he finds out that she is with child and so forth. That's the emphasis is on Matthew, rather on Joseph in the Gospel of Matthew. And the emphasis is on Mary in the Gospel of Luke. Those are the only two Gospels of the Synoptic Gospels, or of the four Gospels, let's say, that speak of the nativity story. John goes from a different perspective altogether, a different perspective because he starts from eternity. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. So he starts from there. And then verse 5 is really fascinating, and that's what we're going to be looking at today. So please stand with me as we're going to look at verse 5, where we read in the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 5, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Let's pray. Father, we are just so grateful. So grateful that we are able to gather this morning and around your precious word, hear these beautiful songs being sung, and we joined in singing as well. It's true, you are worthy. It is true, you are the one who leads us by the quiet waters. You are a God of mercy. And yes, there is hope in Bethlehem. I pray, O Lord, that you would open our eyes this morning, that you would quicken our hearts to receive your wonderful word, to just enjoy these truths and to rejoice together, and then equip us so that we can go out boldly and proclaim this message of hope, because there is such a desperation in our world, and we're the only ones that have this glorious message, and we don't want to keep it to ourselves. Thank you for the church. Thank you for this day. In the precious name of Jesus, amen. Please be seated, beloved. So Christmas, typically, is a time of gifts, of lights, of tinsels, family gatherings, and lots of food. I always enjoy the food part the most. We don't associate Christmas with pain. In fact, whatever pain there is in the world at Christmas time, we try to alleviate it. That's why we give money to the needy or help those who are homeless. And we have food drives and donations at Christmas time. I've heard of truces that take place during Christmas and families that make up at Christmas. Why? Because it's Christmas. And you may have seen those corny movies. How many of you watch corny movies at Christmas? I have. You know those corny movies where, you know, it's typical stuff. There's a girl, and she's lonely, she's unhappy, and then she finds the man of her dreams. Or there's a homeless fellow, and he's all alone, and then he finds a family that welcomes him. Corny movies that happen at Christmas time, that are watched at Christmas time. It's because it's the spirit of Christmas. That's the language we use. No one says it's the spirit of Easter. It doesn't exist. And that's why we don't read passages like this that we're about to read right now, found in Matthew chapter 2, at Christmas. It's the dark side of Christmas. Please open your Bibles to Matthew chapter 2. This passage is very un-Christmassy. Please stay with me. And it is discouraging, but it isn't the final story. Matthew 2:16, we read, "And when Herod saw that he had been tricked by the Magi, he became very enraged and sent men and killed all the boys who were in Bethlehem and all its vicinity who were 2 years old or under, according to the time which he had determined from the Magi. And what had been spoken through Jeremiah, the prophet, was fulfilled. A voice was heard in Ramah, weeping and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, and she refused to be comforted because they were no more." Have you ever seen a nativity scene with sheep, cattle, Mary, baby Jesus, and dead infants? You say, no, that's gory. That doesn't belong, but it does, because it belongs in Scripture. That's what happened when Jesus was born. Hundreds of children were massacred. Somehow we prefer to skip passages like this because we think these don't belong to the Christmas story. We erase it because we want Christmas to stay warm and charming. Had there been death of infants at Easter, well, that would have made sense. Jesus dying and dead children, well, that fits right in. But death of children at Christmas doesn't fit. It doesn't belong. We want no bad news for a few days in the year. We want Christmas to be only good news. We want everything to be cozy, warm, and pain-free. We want wars to cease, orphans to find loving parents, the homeless to get shelter, the lonely girl to find the man of her dreams, and the depressed to find hope. There's a famous movie produced in 1946 starring Jimmy Stewart called It's a Wonderful Life. I'm sure many of you have watched it. I have, several times. It's the story of a man known only as John Doe, and he's threatening to jump off of City Hall on Christmas Eve. His life has been turned upside down. He's lost everything, and he is suicidal. But through the prayers of his loved ones and a very friendly angel called Clarence, he's convinced not to do it because he has shown how his life did make a difference. Now, things are different because he had a role to play in the world. And that is such a warm story. But that is Christmas anesthetized. It's Christmas that isn't truly the whole story. That's our kind of Christmas. The Bible refuses to give us a hollow and cheap story, a cheap Christmas. It pushes back on all the make-belief. It gives us the stark truth. Why? Because good news is only good if we understand the bad news. If we don't understand the bad news, if we don't see how bad it is, then what good news is there? The world has turned Christmas into a fairy tale. This is why we need the Bible. The Bible gives us the truth. It tells us, as John says in these words, that there is darkness, real darkness. It tells us that when the Son of God came into this world that he created, there was hostility, there was sinister action, demons, devils. There was an unwelcoming environment. It was dark. Stop and consider, for example, the very first Christmas. Mary struggled to find a place where she could give birth. Now listen to this. How does that make sense? The God who provides for the Canadian geese to make sure they escape winter and fly south every fall could not provide a home for his only son. A place, a sanitary place where he could be born. Does that make sense? The God who owns the cattle of 1,000 hills could not make sure that his son would be raised in a comfortable habitat instead of in abject poverty. Why? But the most bizarre part of the nativity story is when Herod, this king, this Edomite king, decides to kill all the children, all the boys in Bethlehem and in the vicinity of 2 years and younger. That's why it says a voice was heard in Ramah, weeping and great mourning. All the mothers and the grandmothers, all the parents crying, weeping while Jesus was born. Do you associate pain with Christmas? We don't. Because we've accepted the world's view of Christmas. But that's God's view of Christmas. God could have prevented this tragedy. Why didn't he? Why didn't he? He could have found a sanitary place for his son to be born in. Why didn't he? After all, he's the son of David. He should have been born in a palace, the king. But none of those things happened. To tell us that there is darkness and that the darkness is real, that there is awful news. It's messy, the world. It's difficult and it's horrific. Darkness is real. But how dark is it? As humans, God created us with unique privileges. That's what he did with Adam and Eve, our first parents. He placed them in this beautiful garden and gave them privileges. Privileges unlike anyone has ever seen. The happiest couple, the richest person on earth, the one who has everything you can possibly dream of and has a good attitude and has a positive outlook. Take that individual, if there is such a person, who has everything life could afford, and compare them with Adam, and he falls woefully short. He is not as privileged as Adam was. Adam was gifted and privileged in every way possible. Today, there's a lot of talk about privilege, but he was really privileged. So then why is there this gloom that accompanies the birth of the Savior when you think of it, he is the one who is privileged? Some people say the solution is found in politics. We need to change our politics. Others say the solution is found in science. It's in education. It's in social justice. It's in climate awareness. But there's a solution that is needed far greater than that, because we lost all those privileges in the fall. All of them. We've lost them. The Bible says in Romans chapter 3, verses 10 to 12, that there is no righteous person. So we lost righteousness. There's no one who understands. We lost our capacity to understand what is going on. There's no one who seeks God. We lost our way. We don't know how to find God. We don't know how to pray. We don't know how to turn to Him. We've all turned aside. We know how to sin. We have free will, but it's under bondage. We've become corrupt. There's no one who does good. Even when we do good, it's mixed with evil. It's tainted with self. There's not even one. That's how dark it really is. Far darker than we could imagine. We turned against Him. We're desperately wicked, Jeremiah says. Our good is not good enough. Whatever good we do is drenched in sin. So we may look at Herod and say, my, what an evil man. I would never have done that. Really? Why do Canadians abort 100,000 babies every year and we don't wink? We don't even mourn. We don't even think of that. It's become so commonplace. 100,000 babies every year. Why do we provide doctor-assisted suicide, or as it's euphemistically called, MAID? MAID, which simply means medical assistance in dying or end-of-life care. These are our Herodian-like answers to the problems of our life. Between 2018 and 2019, the numbers of doctor-assisted suicide doubled. In 2019, 5,600 people said, I don't want to live anymore, and asked for a doctor to help them end their life. In 2020, the numbers far out are greater than 2019. We've already beaten the 2019 statistics. Our school system is falling apart. Children are being exposed to the LGBTQ agenda at an early age, not when they're teens, at an early age. There's a push to have parental consent removed if a child is considering transitioning to a new gender. How dark is it? It is very dark. I was speaking to Rose and Vanessa earlier on, and they were saying how they felt this oppression throughout this time. Christmas should be a season of joviality and gladness. Everyone is feeling so down. It's dark. How bankrupt are we? We are so bankrupt that we cannot even begin to understand. It wasn't only bankrupt then. See, we may look at someone like Herod and say, that is awful, that is so wicked, that is so cruel. And John, why do you have to bring this up at Christmas? We're already miserable, please. Don't make us more miserable, because we need to see how dark the world is and how dark our hearts are. Because if we don't see it, we think people like Herod and Hitler and Stalin are the anomalies. That's not really who we are as people. And that is far from the truth. Because all these men are a mirror of who we are deep down. Now, some of you don't believe that. Some of you actually think you're good. And that's why God's grace means nothing to you. So what does John mean when he says, the light shines? in the darkness. Besides rejecting this fanciful and warm, fuzzy idea of Christmas, we need to take God's perspective when it comes to the incarnation. We need to look at the birth of Christ and see it from God's viewpoint, not the anesthetized viewpoint that the world gives us of a little cute baby Jesus born in a manger, surrounded by sheep and cattle, and little Mary holding little Jesus in her arms. There's much more than that. God wants us to see the ugly truth of the darkness, and then he wants us to see that light. The gospel is not embellished ideas. The gospel is good news. Good news. So why did the Lord of glory come the way he did? Simply put, the world God created was now occupied by evil forces, and it required drastic measures. Satan was Lord over mankind, and demons were running the show, filling the earth with sinners who were hopelessly dead in their sin. Something drastic was needed. But what? An invasion. An invasion, not a visit. In June of 1944, the Allied forces joined together to land on the shores of Normandy, France. Germany, Nazi Germany, had been occupying all of Europe. And England was next, and then after that, the Americas, which means Canada and the States. Nothing was stopping Nazi Germany from occupying these countries. So they decided together, under Eisenhower's leadership, to join together the Western world and to, in June of 1944, on June 5th, really, but then it moved to June 6th, to come in at that place in Normandy and fight Nazi Germany on the shores of France. Some of you saw the movie called Saving of Private Ryan. The opening scenes of that movie fails to capture the bloodshed, the horror of D-Day. Soldiers bludgeoned to death, water mixed with blood. That's what you saw on D-Day. People who still are alive say, that movie still doesn't capture it. It was horrific. That was the invasion that the Allied forces planned against Nazi Germany. Yet when we look at Christmas, we see it as a visit. God visiting our world as baby Jesus. And we don't realize that that is not a visit. That is an invasion far greater than the one of D-Day. The incarnation was a visit to deal with the curse and the darkness in our world. That's why the Word became flesh. That's why John says, and light shone in the darkness. It pierced right through it. Our world was filled with pain and sorrow and sin and death and demons. And to undo the effects of the fall, God becomes a baby, enters the womb of a teenage girl, and this was his invasion plan. Our Lord chose to invade this dark world by leaving behind his reign of glory and of privilege. I said before that God is a God of privilege, and that it is. There's no one as privileged as our God. In fact, privilege is his name. His very essence, his privileges are intrinsic. He never earned them. No one had to give them to him. He gives privileges, but he needs none from anyone. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 and 7, we see how the privileged God gave up his privileges. It says, Christ Jesus, who, as he already existed in the form of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. He didn't say, this is my throne, this is my glory, this is my power, this is my kingdom. He didn't say that, but emptied himself by taking the form of a bondservant, of a slave, and being born in the likeness of men. The narrative is that white people are more privileged than blacks, men are more privileged than women, and on it goes. But our privileges, we have them and we don't. Some should have more privileges than others. But no one is as privileged as the Creator. He is light. He is the only one in whom all privileges converge. He has ultimate privileges. And no angel and no human can come up to God and say, "You are privileged. We want some of your privileges." But he is intrinsically privileged because he is light. And as light, God the Son willingly gave up all his privileges, all of them, every single one. See, that's why we know the gospel story cannot be man-made. To carry out the greatest invasion planned by the triune God, he pierced our dark world, and he did it as a weak and defenseless baby. Imagine Eisenhower in June, with all his great generals surrounding his table, sitting together and mapping out this strategic plan. And then he comes out and says, we've got it. We've got the plan for D-Day. On D-Day, we're going to release a baby on the shores of Normandy. That makes no sense. That makes no sense at all. We understand what they did on June 1944. We don't understand what God did at Christmas. We don't understand what he did in Bethlehem. We don't. Because we have nothing to compare it to. But that's what he did. The master became a slave. The all-powerful became weak. The infinite became finite. The owner of all things became poor and disenfranchised. The center of the universe became a nobody. The source of blessing became a curse. The author of life chose to die. Light shines in the darkness. The darkness has not overcome it. What kind of God would do such a thing? I recently read about an Australian radio telescope. It's in space that spanned space for 18 hours, and during that 18-hour period, it discovered, listen to this, 750 galaxies. Not stars. Galaxies. Every galaxy contains between 100 to 150 billion stars. They just discovered another 750 galaxies out there. We can't understand the immensity of this universe. It just goes beyond our capacity to understand. There are over 150 billion galaxies, with each galaxy having over 100 to 150 billion stars. Makes no sense. That this God, who is so great, decides to come to this speck called Earth. That's what it is compared to the universe. It's a speck. To be born in some remote village, in the womb of some obscure teenage girl, and live in Nazareth, to then die on a Roman cross. Why did he do it? Light pierced darkness. Light pierced darkness. It was the invasion of invasions. This is God's D-Day. That's what he did. It was meticulously carried out. It was his plan, conceived in the mind of the triune God, in the council of the Most Holy. And he said, this is how we are going to do it. This was not an afterthought. This was not something, oh my goodness, look what happened in the Garden of Eden. Okay, this is what we're going to plan. No. This was planned way before. That's how great our God is. We would have come up with a different plan altogether. The best we can come up with is what we did on D-Day. Let's join the forces together and let's mount a massive attack against Nazi Germany. That's what we would have come up with. That's the best we could do. God does it with weakness. God does it with nothing. It's remarkable. Light shines into darkness, John says, and darkness has not overcome it. I would have written this verse differently. I would have said, light shines in the darkness, and light grows and overpowers darkness, because that's what happens. You turn on a light switch, and darkness is no more. But it doesn't say that. It says, and darkness has not overcome it. Why? It gives the idea that darkness here is so powerful that it tries to overcome it. And that's what darkness is trying to do since then. But the church triumphs because Jesus said, I am building my church and the gates of Hades will not prevail. So no matter what the enemy throws at us, no matter how much pain, no matter how much suffering, no matter how many viruses come our way, no matter how often the church is being put down and bludgeoned and persecuted and crushed, we continue to rise because it's God's church. The power of darkness cannot overcome it. That's the message of the gospel. We are sinners. We deserve to be annihilated with the rest of the demons, this entire globe, just to be crushed because of darkness. We sided with the enemy. We committed cosmic treason. We turned against this holy God. We said no to him. And yet here God in his infinite mercy plans this invasion, this heavenly, holy invasion. And through this birth begins the unraveling of the powers of darkness. And we, Church of Christ, are part of the unraveling plan. We are part of the undoing of Satan and his forces. We are in the midst of it. This is a glorious moment. We're part of what God is doing. So for those of you who are still on the dark side, is the gospel right now meaning something to you? Is the Holy Spirit speaking to you? If you don't believe in the gospel, in this glorious message, in this glorious plan, if you find it so foolish as the Greeks in Paul's day and as the Jews in his day and the Romans as well, they looked at Paul and said, you're out of your mind. How could this save us? Because when we don't believe in the gospel, we are saving ourselves. And that's why we have every possible idea floating around and how to save the planet, how to save mankind, trying to find a way to continue humanity on another planet and all these other ideas that float around out there. But not the gospel, but the church. The church believes in the gospel. And if you believe in the gospel, then you move from darkness to light. Your sins are forgiven. Your name is written in the book of life. In fact, it was written way before. Once this light enters your heart, this is what happens. And Colossians 1:13 says it beautifully. Because in that day, the light pierced the darkness and continues to pierce darkness every time someone believes in the gospel. Paul says it this way. For he rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. That's what happens when God moves in your heart sovereignly. You are forgiven, you are redeemed, you are rescued, you are transferred from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of God's Son, the kingdom of light. What an amazing God. What an amazing plan. Let's praise him. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you because indeed the light shone in the darkness. It pierced it, and darkness cannot overcome it. You are winning. We look around us, and we don't necessarily see that because we're like Elisha's servant Gehazi. He says, look at the enemies. Look how big and numerous they are. We need our eyes to be opened, so open our eyes as we read scriptures Open our eyes to see the truths that you have revealed in these pages for our benefit, for our encouragement. Thank you again. Draw anyone, Lord, who's listening to this message and is still in the dark. I pray that the light would pierce his or her heart and that he and she would be drawn and transferred into the kingdom of your beloved Son. Glorify Jesus once again by saving many in this day, we pray. Amen.
Incarnate love divine, star and angel gave the sign. Bow to babe on bended knee, the savior of humanity. Unto us a child.
A child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
Thank you.
Beloved, may the extravagant love of God, amazing grace of our Savior, and the fellowship, matchless fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.